Lord Christopher Monckton, 3rd Viscount of Monckton and Brenchley, formerly a member of the Conservative Party. Monckton has been the deputy leader of the UK Independence Party since 2010. He served in Conservative central office and worked with Margaret Thatcher at number 10 and policy unit advising her. He's also an award-winning journalist and scientist who's also an inventor. And the website is scienceandpublicpolicy.org. He really doesn't need any introduction. We only have him for about 30 minutes. So in the interest of time, Lord Monckton, we now see the head of the Goddard Space Center. We see Bert, Maurice Strong, we see Ted Turner. They all say we want a post-industrial world, but China can build 3 to 5 new power plants a week. Obama won't let any new ones open here. And now I have the article out of the Daily Telegraph, era of constant electricity at home is ending, says Power Chief, and he says that it's true, that it's good, that England will be like North Korea in the next 10 years, and that you won't have power a lot of the time, but that's good to cut your carbon footprint.
It's just pathetic how the entire governing class has become infected with what really one could only call a sort of post-Marxist desperation. They are longing to shut down the economies of the West. And when the likes of you and me, Alex, began saying this, that this was their real agenda, we were told we were extremists, we were lunatics, we were frothing at the mouth, we didn't know what we were talking about. Now they're coming out more and more openly and saying it publicly. And instead of the wall-to-wall outrage that ought to be happening, people are just saying, yes, we got used to these people, they say this sort of thing, perhaps they don't really mean it. Just the same kind of rabbit-in-the-headlights response as we saw in the run-up to Hitler, when he began saying similar extraordinary things, and people just quietly looked the other way and said, well, let's all be nice to him and hope that he goes away. The fact is, we can't allow these people any longer to get away with what they're getting away with. What they're doing is exploiting our democratic tolerance and understanding in the hope that they can destroy it forever and shut it down and put in its place something a great deal more authoritarian. Let me give you, first of all, a bit of background to the chief of the National Grid here in the UK. Now, what he's talking about, though he hasn't admitted it publicly, but I have made some investigations privately, so I can tell your viewers and listeners, and you can be the first to know this, that during the cold snap, indeed the coldest December since records began in 1659 in central England, the power grid came in the UK, throughout the whole of the UK, within just 3% of its capacity. And of course, if you reach anything like that capacity, you can trip the whole grid out and black out not just part of the country, but the whole country. That very, very nearly happened. Why did it happen? Because the government here, which in all three of the major parties, so-called, doesn't believe in the coal-fired and gas-fired electricity which our economy was built on.
And by the way, Lord Monckton, that actually happened all over the U.S., and the White House actually attacked PrisonPlanet.com in our article and said we were liars, that they didn't have an anti-power plant agenda. But then the next week, their energy secretary came out and said we're going to have massive coal plant closures on top of what they've already had. And now the head of your energy program says get ready to not have power a lot of the time.
That's right. I mean, and the background to this is that we very nearly didn't get it. And why? It's because the windmills that are supposed to be generating 5% of our electricity weren't generating any. Their contribution to the grid in December was 0.0% because the wind basically didn't blow. We were under a blocking high. That's when you need the windmills the most, and they're not there. So closing down these coal plants and thinking you can replace them with useless windmills that cost 26 times as much to generate electricity, this is not a forward-thinking, radical or sensible green energy policy. The only green energy policy that would work to keep the lights on and the wheels of industry turning, and prosperity as well, is to go nuclear if you don't want to keep the coal-fired plants.
But of course,
the
coal-fired plants... And quite frankly, Lord Monckton, and we'll get your view on this on the other side, I think that nukes overall are not as good as coal. We got so much of it. It's completely clean now. And carbon dioxide is good for plants. I say more cold plants. Good for the earth. Lord Christopher Monckton is our guest. He is the leading voice and expert with precision, cutting up the lies and propaganda of the fake environmental lobby who could care less about the earth and real environmental problems that we do certainly have. It's all about grabbing resources. Similar to Obama handing out 1,040 waivers to McDonald's and others, where their hundreds of thousands of employees don't have to get insurance, but then their competition does. So this is also about kingmaking, where you've got to get the licensure, not evenly from government of the people, but licensed to be able to operate. And again, here's the Daily Telegraph. This is their words, not mine. This is written by the head of the energy program there in England. The UK power chief says that the days of permanently available electricity may be coming to an end. And it goes on, the head of the power network said yesterday, and then it has the quotes from him saying, yes, we're going to change our behavior, consume less. But yes, it's not going to be cheap. It's not going to be easily available. And you will not have power all the time as a society, that this is clear. I mean, there's no doubt. But then meanwhile, the UN lobbies in England to shut down the oldest steel plant in England, and then give the money to Pachauri at the UN to move it to India. I mean, isn't this really just about the globalists have made their investments in China, and if they can shut down Western Europe, England, the U.S., their investments go up? I mean, it's not just hatred of America in England. I mean, that's the cherry on top. But I mean, isn't it more just about shutting down their competition, Lord Monckton?
There's certainly a very big element of greed and self-interest on the part of the neo-Marxists who are doing to us what they are doing to us. And just to go back to what the head of the grid said, he said this because windmills have been destabilizing the national grid. Nobody who operates a centralized grid likes to have windmills on it because they're so unpredictable. You can't plan for when the wind's going to blow and when it's suddenly going to stop. And so it destabilizes the entire structure and puts all your power at risk. But the more serious underlying problem is that because the governing class has gone stupid and has allowed itself to be fooled by a tiny clique of mad, bad scientists into believing that adding a little carbon dioxide to the atmosphere is going to cause major changes to the climate, when we've now had 60 years of evidence that it isn't going to make major changes to the climate. They're banning the building of new coal-fired plants. You were mentioning Obama having done that, having then told you were a liar when you said he'd done it. He said, before the election had even taken place, that he intended to shut down coal-fired plants and to make coal prohibitively expensive and to tax people who used it and punish them for using it. And now he's trying to tell you you're a liar when he actually does what he said he was going to do. It is a disgrace that they are attacking the coal industry in this way, which is one of the bravest and most useful industries we have. Modern methods of burning coal are not dangerous. They don't pollute. They do put a little carbon dioxide into the atmosphere.
Well, Lord Monckton, please explain that. Please explain that, because I've happened to, you know, study it myself. In the modern plants, nothing comes out but water vapor and carbon dioxide. They run it through a whole bunch of different cleaning systems, condensers. It's all purified out. But then the media gets up there and says, these plants are incredibly toxic. We've got to stop the carbon pollution because all that's left is carbon dioxide. So they spin it and call carbon dioxide carbon, scaring people. I mean, this is pure deception.
It is pure deception, and it means they haven't kept abreast with the really quite dramatic changes in the technology for burning coal in power stations. And let me describe, if I may, just one or two of the things that are now being done. A colleague of mine called Steve Whittaker at Cambridge, when I was there, was already studying this and had come to the conclusion that you could improve the methods of combustion known as circulating fluidized bed construction, combustion, by which you crush the coal into small particles and then you kind of have it on a cushion of air and burn it that way, very, very hot. And very little dirt comes out of that process because the combustion is made much more complete. And the more complete the combustion, the fewer the particulate bits of pollution you get out of it.
It's turbocharged.
The few that remain, they now scrub out by using flue gas scrubbing, by using various methods of washing, so that, as you say, all that you really get out of a coal plant these days is water vapor, which is harmless, and CO2, which is not just harmless, it's beneficial.
Very well said. Now, going back to the previous question, what's your view on nuclear versus coal?
There's no doubt that we need both, because we're going to get this continuing pressure on the coal industry. It began under the KGB in the 1970s and early 80s. It was they who engineered the two miner strikes in the UK, one of which brought down Edward Heath's government in 1974, and another where they tried to do the same again in 1982-3, and they failed because we were ready for them. But we were able to trace how the leader of the miners' union had been trained in Moscow first for 3 weeks at the Patrice Lumumba Institute, where they trained the various junior terrorists. Then they.
By the way, the Russian government's pushing peak oil as well today.
Well, we'll come on to that in a moment. Let me just tell this story
about
the miners' union, because they then sent him to the Lenin Institute, where the really serious terrorists like Yasser Arafat were trained, and he was then sent back to Britain to try to destroy our energy-based economy by shutting down the coal industry. And he didn't succeed. We beat him. And now Obama is doing the same thing, but this time from the president's office, no longer directed by the KGB, because he believes the same sort of things as the KGB believed in those days, and he seems to me to be perfectly willing to shut America down for reasons which are very difficult to fathom, because this is, whether he likes it or not, his country now. Even if he was born in Kenya, as some say, the fact is he's now an American citizen. And as an American citizen, he owes a duty of loyalty to his country. And you don't go around shutting down the country's primary source of energy if you really believe in the future of your country. It's the wrong way for a president to behave, and he should stop doing that. He should also look, in my view, much more carefully at the science behind this climate nonsense, which is now, frankly, collapsing with every new scientific paper that comes out. It's now blindingly clear. There's been a very important paper published just a few months ago by Dr. Roy Spencer, whom I'm sure you know well, of the University of Alabama at Huntsville, who does all the satellite monitoring. And he has discovered that the effect of the extra water vapor in the atmosphere as it gets warmer is to increase the thickness of low clouds, which reflect more of the sunlight back into space. And that actually causes a cooling of the planet, which largely offsets any warming you might get from CO2 and greatly changes all the numbers, so that we're not going to see very much warming over the next 100 years at all. Maybe he thinks half a degree Celsius, maybe 1 degree Celsius, that's 2 degrees Fahrenheit, absolute max. This is not, on any view, any kind of a problem. So we need to go right back to the science and remember there is no need to do any of this. But then you talk of the alternative energies that they're trying to, these windmills they're putting up everywhere, for instance, which kill birds in large numbers, but they don't produce very much electricity. The electricity they do produce is produced at monumental cost. The largest such wind farm in the world is the Thanet Wind Array, that's just off the coast of Kent in England. And that is subsidized to the tune of $2 billion for one wind farm over the next 20 years, guaranteed by the British taxpayer, whether he likes it or not, through the government. And if every measure to make global warming go away were as cost ineffective as the Thanet Wind Array, then to forestall the 3.4 Celsius or 6.8, around 6 Fahrenheit degrees of warming that the UN expects to happen in the next 100 years would cost 20% of world gross domestic product, of all the goods and services we produce all the way around the world. 20% would have to be devoted just to making global warming go away.
Well, Lord Monckton.